So there is no common view on what exactly is Internet of Things, but I think that all agree that it is a step on a path to something bigger, something that's been in people's imagination for a very long time. And I trace this back to one of the fathers of the wireless communications, who said this in an interview 90 years ago. So for him, this big thing, he calls it a world converted into a huge brain. And then in an interview in 2013, Bill Vasek, who is an editor of the Wired magazine, he said something like this. So for him, world will transform into the platform on which you can run software in a pretty much same way that you run it on a computer or on a smartphone. And this will be so-called programmable world, where all our objects will work as one. And that sounds pretty much the same as what Tesla said 90 years ago. So this great vision, it hasn't changed much, just the names have changed, and today I will call it programmable world. So on this path towards the programmable world, we should go through several steps, right? And what are those steps? As I said, IoT is one of these steps. So the first step is to get things connected, to the internet, to this central nerve system of the world. And this phase started a long time ago. So John Romke, who was one of the developers of the original TCP/IP protocol stack, he created an internet-connected toaster in 1990. And this toaster, you could simply turn it on and off from a PC. It didn't do much more than that. And he presented that at the Interop conference in 90. And then he improved on his design next year, and he added a robotic hand that would insert a piece of bread and take it out later. So why did he do this? What was his intention? He simply wanted to show that his TCP/IP protocol stack can work on an ordinary, everyday device. And he also did it as a response to the challenge of the organizers of this Interop conference. So we don't really know if he had a bigger purpose for his internet-connected toaster, and whether this idea of Internet of Things already existed in his mind at that time. So at that time, when John Romke did this, the term Internet of Things didn't exist. It was coined later by Kevin Ashton, who was the director of the MIT Auto ID Center, which was later renamed to something. And he spoke about the Internet of Things in the context of using RFID in retail. So he had this idea that all products in retail will be tagged with RFIDs, and that you can use them to track them in the store and on the way to the store. And then when you come to the checkout, you know, you can read this RFID and customer's account will be automatically charged. So that was in 1990, but it was not until 2005 that mainstream media started to use this term. And although the technology and the products were coming slowly on the market, you know, at some moment, we don't know why, the media latched on, and then we have this boom here. So this created an impression that Internet of Things is something very lucrative, and the big players decided to jump on the train and they started publishing their predictions on how many trillions of dollars in revenue IoT is going to create. And then that in turn, fueled this media frenzy. So we have this phenomenon. But now we want to see how real is this, right? So I was talking about this first stage where things get connected to the internet. So let's see how many things do we actually have connected to the internet. So this shows the number of things versus people. I don't mean literally people connected to the internet, but devices such as tablets, PCs, and mobile phones, these personal devices that are mainly used to communicate human-created content. And we see that now in 2015, we still live in the era of the Internet of People. We have more people connected than things. And of course, this is going to change over time. But how significant is this, this quantitative change? For example, now you have these smart light bulbs, like Wi-Fi equipped light bulbs. And how many light bulbs you have in the home, like 5, 10? And if you replace all of them with smart light bulbs, then we will have many of these things. But do we have Internet of Things? Is many connected things the same as the Internet of Things? Well, it depends on the point of view. There's some companies that say, okay, in this year, the number of connected things have exceeded the number of connected people. So we declare this year as a birthday of the Internet of Things. But what I think is that in addition to this quantitative change, there is also some qualitative change that needs to happen. So what is this qualitative change? These things need to start talking to each other. They should be able to be orchestrated, composed, so that they can interact and enable themselves to do something that they were not able to do before in isolation. And that is the second stage in this path towards the programmable world. And this is what I would call Internet of Things. So the key word here is interoperability. So we need interoperability as an enabler for the programmable world. But let's try to define it in a more formal way. So in the first bullet, this is how I see Internet of Things. Internet of Things is an innovation platform that enables new applications by orchestrating interconnected objects, right? And here the stress is on interoperability, and that there are some people who see it a bit differently. So they say that the Internet of Things is a world where connected devices and sensors collect and share data to enable better decision making. What kind of decision making? It could be like a sprinkler that turns on and off based on the input from a soil moisture sensor. It could be an automated car driving algorithm that makes decisions based on the input from the onboard sensors or sensors deployed somewhere along the road. It could be some manufacturing process. It could be some business decision making. But the key word here is big data, as something that cascades from the Internet of Things. And then some people say that Internet of Things is comprised of the technologies that enable more direct integration between the physical world and computer-based systems. So this is about, melting of software and hardware. It's about pushing intelligence to the object. So the key word is intelligence. So you see that people from different lines of work, they look at the Internet of Things from different perspectives, and they find different key defining properties of the Internet of Things, like interoperability, big data, intelligence. And maybe the most accurate thing to say, most correct thing to say, is that the Internet of Things is all this together. And then some people may ask, what is then machine-to-machine communication? You know, we radio systems engineer, we tend to put equation sign between those things, two things, like M2M, this is actually IoT. But in fact, machine-to-machine is more about providing physical connectivity between the objects and meeting the quality of service requirements, like ultra-high reliability, very short latency, etc. So machine-to-machine communication is actually the plumbing for the Internet of Things, something that sits lower in the protocol stack, while Internet of Things is something much broader. So let's see what are the markets that Internet of Things is going to transform. These markets are typically classified into the consumer-facing and business-facing IoT markets. Among consumer-facing, we have smart home, we have lifestyle, health, and mobility, and within each of these IoT market segments, we have number of possible applications. And then business-facing IoT is about retail, it's about energy, about smart cities, manufacturing, agriculture, etc. And some predictions say that there is a more business or revenue potential in the business-facing IoT, which is probably right. But the fact is that customer-facing IoT segment is leading the way. Because you know businesses are a bit conservative, and to develop and roll out projects, products or services for the business-facing IoT, that takes some time. So currently, business-facing IoT is lagging behind customer-facing IoT. And let's elaborate a bit more on this. By looking into some, market intelligence data. So these are some results of the surveys in the area of customer-facing IoT. These are obtained by surveying 2,000 households in U.S. So these are probably households that have broadband connection. So the study could be, you know, these are people who tend to be early adopters, so the study is a bit biased. But they were asked what IoT product, customer-facing IoT product, of course, are they expecting to purchase in next year, next 5 years from now, etc. And it seems that most of them are interested in things for home automation, so smart home market. These are like smart thermostat, connected security, and smart refrigerators. And currently, the big hype is about wearables, you know, all kinds of gadgets, like fitness gadgets. And those things, they have the highest adoption quite right now. But it seems that this hype is over. And then, if you look into the business-facing IoT, there were a number of surveys that are looking at different metrics. So let me just explain briefly what these numbers mean. So Cisco and Pricewaters, they were looking at the percentage of companies that are going to invest in IoT in the next 3 years. Okay, this is it's clear what it means. Yeah. It's a future projection. And then The Economist was looking into the business index. So what is this business index? It's it tells you, it's a number between 1 and 10. It tells you how much a company relies on IoT externally in its products and services, but also internally in its internal processes. So one, it means it doesn't rely on IoT at all. 10 means it relies on IoT to the highest possible extent. And number 4 is something like we are in the research phase. So this business index tells you about the present time, and this investment index tells you about the future adoption. So if you look at these numbers, you can see that energy, mobility, and manufacturing are 3 IoT markets that hold the highest potential for the next 3 years. And in particular, in the energy sector, that's oil and gas. In the mobility sector, connected cars, like autonomous driving. And in the manufacturing, oil and gas, mobility, connected cars, and energy smart meters, right? Smart meters and smart grid. So now I'll give you some examples of the real IoT products that exist now. Big Belly, it's a waste disposal and recycling system deployed in few big cities in US like New York and Philadelphia. These are solarly powered waste disposal stations that connect to the cloud via SMS. And there is a cloud-based web platform where you can track in real time like the volume of the garbage in these bins. And based on that, the waste management company can dispatch their trucks at the right time and to the right location. And then we have world sensing fast, I'll call it fast park. This is not a spelling error. It's really called like this, fast PRK. And this system allows drivers to easily find the parking spot based on the data that is transmitted from the sensors embedded into the asphalt, which detect the presence of a car above. And then this data is transmitted via Sigfox to the smartphone application or to the electronic panels that are placed around the city. And this can be used to alleviate the congestion in the city center. It will help make the city greener, etc. And you can correlate this parking occupancy data with the payment data. So there is an API towards the mobile payment systems. And then city or parking authority can figure out if there are many free riders in a certain part of the city, and they can dispatch the teams to write fines. It can also be used to monitor parking places that are reserved for like police, firefighters, or disabled, and even detect if the car that is parked in the spot is eligible to do that or not. And then we have Owlet Night Shift. It's a smart road lighting control system. It's been deployed about fast parking. It's been deployed in many cities. Like the biggest deployment is in Moscow, 50,000 of these sensors, 50,000 parking spaces covered. There is also a deployment in Poland, in Łódź, although a much smaller, like 30 sensors, but they expand quickly. And OLED Night Shift, it's been deployed in some US cities like San Jose. And it consists of these luminary controllers that are attached to the luminaries, basically to the light bulbs, and they allow these luminaries to be controlled, like dimmed, turned off, and they measure the energy consumption, and they transmit all this data via ZigBee to the section controllers, and then from the section controllers, this data is connected to the transmitted to the cloud-based management platform that, you know, every employee of the city electrical distribution company can use at any time and at any location to check the status of the lights. Then in the mobility IoT markets, we have quite some number of pilots testing autonomous driving cars. So here you see some buses, self-driven buses that are deployed as part of the Framework Program 7 project called City Mobile 2 in Trikala. It's a small city in Greece. And these cars connect to the infrastructure for localization purposes, and they connect to the traffic lights. And they run on a dedicated lane, so there is actually not much interaction with other vehicles apart from detecting if something or someone is blocking this lane. And then Google has been testing its self-driving car since 2012 on public roads, so not on a dedicated lane. And so far, these self-driving vehicles have covered 2 million miles. So these self-driving cars by Google, they rely on an expensive piece of equipment that is mounted on the top of the car. And this thing is creating a detailed 3D map of the environment. And then this map is enriched with input from the sensors that are installed on board of the vehicles or that are installed in the roadside infrastructure. And then these maps are uploaded to the cloud where they can be used by other vehicles. So there is an ongoing discussion on how much connectivity do we need to make these autonomous cars work? How much connectivity and what are the connectivity patterns and QoS? So I think all agree that we need some vehicle to infrastructure communication, but the need for car-to-car communication is very often disputed. For example, Google doesn't believe in it. Google cars, they don't talk to each other. And the self-driving algorithm implemented in Google cars, it doesn't make decisions based on real-time input from other cars. It does that kind of indirectly based on the historical data that other cars upload to the map. Then if we look at the shopping and retail, there are lots of kind of fun products there. There is this bit tag, which is a physical tag that connects retails to the cryptocurrencies like Bitcoin. So it's a small piece of hardware that shows the name of the product, the price in the local currency like US dollars or euros, and the price, real-time updated price in bitcoins. And then this tag can communicate via Bluetooth Low Energy with a tablet. So you can place it on a tablet to initiate a Bitcoin transaction. You can also do it in a different way. You can take it, you can shake it, and it will generate a QR code that appears on this small display, and then you can scan it with your smartphone to initiate Bitcoin transaction. And then we have Amazon Dash, which consists of two types of products. There is this Amazon Dash. It's an internet ordering service. So there is this Amazon Dash scanner, which you can use to scan the code on the product, and then it is placed automatically. It connects via Wi-Fi to your home Wi-Fi network, and the product is automatically placed into your shopping cart. Or it also has a microphone, so you can do some voice recognition. You can just tell what you want, and it will be placed in the cart. And they also have these dash buttons, these small plastic things that have battery and they have Wi-Fi inside. And you can stick it to your fridge or your washing machine. And then you can program it to point to a certain product, type of a product and the quantity of the product. And then you just push the button and you have it delivered in 2 days. And then QuirKey Egg Minder, it's an egg tray basically, which has weight sensors and Wi-Fi connectivity. And you put the eggs and then this tray detects when they're added and it synchronizes to your smartphone app and it notifies you when they're close to their expiry date and or when you run low and you need to restock them. And you know, this featured in the Jay Leno Tonight Show and you can buy it for $14 on Amazon. There are also lots of sport gadgets, which basically put sensors somewhere on a sportsman's clothes or inside his accessory, like a tennis racket. And these sensors then can track the location of the sportsman or track its movement. So there is this zebra motion work, which is a sensor that is placed on the shoulders of a football player, American football player. And it is based on the ultra wideband. So it can do a very precise time difference flight of the arrival, based on which you can do the location, you can calculate the location of the player. And then it streams this data in real time to a cloud from where different statistics can be calculated and shown in a live broadcast, or they can be presented to a coach to improve on the performance of his team. And this has been used in the National Football League in US since last year, 2014. And then you have something like Zip Golf, a Bluetooth sensor that you put in a glove when you play golf. And it measures your swing characteristics and shows them on the in a smartphone app and gives you some tips, some statistics and tips on how to improve. And then there is a big smart home market and lots of products there. There is a Philips Hue, which is smart lighting system. There are these light bulbs that you can control with your smartphone app, like create a dimming profile or a time schedule. Or you can synchronize them to the music or to a movie to extend the experience to the whole room. And this is based on the Apple HomeKit. So you can also use Siri to control the light with your voice. And then the famous Nest thermostat. Nest was bought by Google, so basically this is a Google Nest thermostat, which, of course, you can control with your smartphone, but what is interesting, it also learns your daily patterns, your habits, like when you get up in the morning, when do you go to shower, and then it will... it will control the heating system in your home to save energy. And this Nest thermostat can also talk to the Philips Hue. So if it detects that you have left the home, it can tell Philips Hue to switch off the light. And then we have Amazon Echo, which is like a voice control hub. So it has a microphone and a speaker. And it listens continuously for certain trigger words. And when it's triggered, you can tell him to switch off the Philips Hue or to change the temperature using the Nest thermostat. So it's already an ecosystem, like three devices from different vendors, Philips, Nest, and Amazon, working together. So that was that basically concludes the first part of my presentation, and then I will tell you a bit about the landscape of IoT technologies, starting from the wireless technologies. So of course, to connect things together, we need some wireless technology, and there is not one that can meet the requirements of all different IoT applications. Now, the software developers should be, a product developer should be able to choose from a different, from a wide spectrum, so that they can design the most cost-effective solutions. And these wireless technologies that are nowadays used in the IoT products can be categorized in many different things, and typically they are categorized into the local area and wide area technologies. They could be also divided into licensed and non-licensed, into standardized and proprietary, IP-based or non-IP-based. In Nokia, we are often talking, and you heard that from Matthias and Fernando's presentation, about massive and mission-critical applications and technologies. So while the first four are clear, maybe I can briefly tell what the massive and mission-critical are. Massive IoT means very low-cost devices, under $5, very low power consumption, so device should run 10 years on a pair of AA batteries. And then very high density of these devices, low data rates and bursty traffic, so not kind of like a streaming, but bursts. And typical applications are health, wearables, inventory tracking, and environment monitoring. On the other side of the spectrum, we have mission-critical IoT, where crucial things are very low latency, under 5 milliseconds end-to-end, ultra-high reliability, which refers to the ability of the system to deliver data with a reliability of, let's say, 10 to the minus 8, so one frame error in every 10 to the 8 frame transmissions within certain latency bounds. It is characterized by low to high data rate, burst your streaming traffic. Maybe you need to stream a video from a security camera. And applications are tactile internet, like remote surgery, for example, and industrial automation, autonomous driving, and augmented reality. In this corner, massive IoT, we have many different technologies. This is already in the scope of standardization. Well, we have proprietary technologies, and we have technologies that will be standardized in 2016. This is a fairly new area. There is lots of research going on, like in 5G, what you heard in the previous presentation. And these technologies have still a long way to go. So it is there's no clear cut between massive and mission critical. There are lots of applications that fall somewhere in between these two categories. You have, for example, you have smart toys, right? They're not in the massive IoT because you don't need to run them for 10 years on a pair of batteries. You can replace them every month. But they also might require some streaming, like mission critical. Some audio or a video, for example. So I will not base my classification on massive versus mission critical. I will do it the usual way, local area versus wide area. So among the local area technologies, we have currently four big players. We have Zigbee, Z-Wave, Bluetooth Low Energy, and Wi-Fi. Zigbee and Z-Wave are kind of similar because they are both based on the same physical layer, IEEE 802.15.4. But the main difference is that they are using different frequency bands. So Zigbee operates in 2.4 gigahertz, while Z-Wave is in 900 megahertz range. So Zigbee overlaps with, as you can see, with Bluetooth and Wi-Fi. There is some interference and possible reliability problems. Also, there are many Zigbee chipset manufacturers and many different Zigbee stack vendors, which also creates kind of compatibility problems. While for Z-Wave, there is only one chip vendor, Sigma Design, and there is only one stack. So there are no compatibility problems. But I think things are going to improve for Zigbee with the upcoming Zigbee 3.0 standard, which will unify all these things. When we look at the data rates, we see that Zigbee can support 250 kilobits per second, while Z-Wave is only 40 kilobits per second. And Zigbee chipsets are somewhat cheaper. So these are two big competitors. They are targeting exactly the same market. Home automation is the main market for both. Then we have Bluetooth, which is extremely low cost, extremely power efficient, and it can support data rates higher than either Zigbee or Z-Wave. But it also has some problems. First, it has a very short range of 10 meters only, and it doesn't support meshing like Zigbee and Z-Wave, so you cannot create as big networks as with Zigbee. But Bluetooth Special Interest Group is working on a meshing standard, which is actually going to be like a Bluetooth profile, not an amendment to the core standard, so you will not need new chips. And that will make Bluetooth low energy a very, very attractive technologies. And some predictions say that this will be the fastest growing IoT short range technology in the next 5 years. And then, of course, we have Wi-Fi. Wi-Fi offers many advantages. First, it has clearly defined standards. It has good security solutions. There is a large base of installed devices and networks that you can reuse. It natively supports IP, which is not the case with Bluetooth and Zigbee. You need some convergence layer on top of this, on top of Zigbee and Bluetooth. But Wi-Fi also has one major problem. It is very power hungry. And you can read announcement from different Wi-Fi chip vendors that they created an ultra low power Wi-Fi chip. And what this actually means, right? Did they invent some new Wi-Fi technology? No, they just optimize their firmware so that it uses less CPU cycles. You can run it on a smaller, less energy-consuming MCU. So this ultra-low power, it refers to the total system energy, not only to Wi-Fi energy. Then if we move to the wide area IoT technologies, we have this low power wide area segment. These are cellular-like, not truly cellular, but cellular-like proprietary technologies like Sigfox and the LoRa. These two technologies are quite similar. The main difference is that Sigfox is ultra narrow band, while LoRa is using wideband CDMA. They are targeting the same market. They have approximately the same cost. They are comparable in terms of energy efficiency. Sigfox supports, LoRa supports higher bit rate. But there is one major advantage of Sigfox. It's in the business model they are quite advanced in the terms of deployment. So they have national-wide coverage in Spain, in France, in Netherlands. I mentioned that the smart parking solution in Moscow is using Sigfox, so there is coverage in Moscow. Coverage in 10 big cities in UK and the plans to provide national coverage in US by the end of 2016. There is also a Sigfox provider in Warsaw who is planning to, you know, go nationwide. I'm not sure about the time plan. So we have these two proprietary technologies which use this, you know, white space created by the lack of 3GPP standards for the long-range IoT technologies, and they jumped in. But there are some 3GPP standard, upcoming 3GPP standards that will appear in the first half of the next year. And there will be actually two flavors of LTM, which stands for, it's like LTM for machine-to-machine communication. There will be a version that runs on 1.4 megahertz channel bandwidth, and the narrowband version, which runs on 200 kilohertz. Which is labeled NB-LTM, so narrowband LTM. So LTM will support 1 megabit per second, narrowband version will support up to 150 kilobits per second, and they will compete with Sigfox and LoRa. The advantage will be that they will provide ubiquitous coverage wherever, you know, you have LTE operator covering an area, you will also have an LTM and narrowband LTM coverage, and deployment is possible either in shared spectrum, so you can have your LTM or narrowband LTM mixed with normal LTE traffic, or you could have a dedicated carrier from the refarmed GSM resources. Or you could even deploy a narrowband version of LTM in a guard band. There is another technology that 3GPP is working on. It's called Extended Coverage GSM. And it will allow mobile operators to provide M2M service using their legacy GSM networks. So that is basically the landscape of these wide area technologies. And as you can see from this, all these technologies are targeting massive IoT. So you may wonder, what about mission critical IoT? Well, we have 5G, this famous triangle. So I will not go into details because Fernando already explained this. So 5G is expected to cover a wide range of scenarios in addition to the mobile broadband, which is here in this corner. We have massive type communication and mission critical type communication. And how is 5G going to achieve this? It will be done in a way that you have this versatile radio that you can optimize for either corner of this triangle by changing, for example, carrier frequencies or TTI length or cyclic prefix length, etc. And of course, every optimization to one of these application domains comes at a price, because there is a fundamental trade-off between the spectral efficiency, latency and reliability, so you can make your radio more reliable and it can provide shorter latency, but it comes at the price of reduced spectral efficiency. So as you can see, just to sum up this section about the wireless technologies, there is a variety of wireless technologies, and some of them are competing for the same IoT market. Some of them are targeting different markets. Some people talk about the standards war. It's not really a war. They won't be a one winning technologies. There will be many technologies targeting different use cases. And this is not really a problem for IoT because interoperability in IoT is supposed to be achieved somewhere up in the protocol stack on the through standardization or through middleware and not through the use of the same wireless technologies for your, all your use cases. And what about the protocols? This is how a typical IoT protocol stack looks like. So we have different wireless technologies here at the bottom. And then somewhere along the communication link, we have IP, IP version 6. And then, you can push IP to the end nodes, to the smart objects, but in many cases that doesn't make sense. You can connect those objects using a proprietary non-IP protocol to a gateway, and then from the gateway to the internet using IP. As I mentioned, some of the technologies are not IP compatible, so to say. For example, Bluetooth and Zigbee, they are using very short frame sizes into which you cannot fit an IPv6 packet. So you need to have this kind of compression and segmentation, convergence sublayer like 6.0.PAN. And very often you will need to mesh these devices. And for that you will need routing algorithms. And IETF has defined several of those. So we have Ripple for static sensor networks. We have AODV for mobile ad hoc networks. And then on top of IPv6, you can have either UDP for very constrained devices, or you can have TCP and different security solutions. But for those, you have transport layer security for TCP and the datagram version of the same. So datagram transport layer security for DTLS. And then here the things become messy in the application layers. There are many different standards, different protocols for the Internet of Things. We could use HTTP, but HTTP is too heavy for severely constrained devices. So there is kind of a lightweight version of HTTP, which is called Constrained Application Protocol, CoAP. And it can be directly mapped to the HTTP. It uses this REST architecture. So you have client-server exchanging requests and response. And those requests and response are like put, get, delete, post. And on a co-op server, there are resources defined by a URL. And you can access those real URL and perform each of these four primitives that I mentioned. And then on top of co-op, there is lightweight M2M protocol, which is a device management protocol that uses co-op primitives to manage the device. And then there are a number of protocols which are not using the REST architecture. These are more published subscribed based protocols, which are used either for device-to-server communication or device-to-people, or device like a special case of device-to-server, or device-to-device or server-to-server. So I will not into the details of those. So that's the protocol landscape. There are many more. These are the most popular ones. When it comes to hardware, there are lots of prototyping hardwares for IoT, and that's good. Why? Because rapid prototyping is very important for IoT. You know, back in the 90s, the development cycle for a product was 2 to 3 years, and now, you know, all these crowd-funded projects, they have development cycle a few months, and you really need to be quick. You need to start from some platform rather than from scratch and test your ideas before you go to a manufacturer to print a PCB for your product. And there are different kinds of platforms. There are general purpose boards like Raspberry Pi, Arduino, and WaspMote. You're probably familiar for those. You can add all kinds of shields to them to add sensing capabilities, to add wireless communication like Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, shields, GSM modems, etc. You can add cameras, all kinds of different accessories. And then there are specialized shields, like there is RFduino, which is a Bluetooth low energy shield. There is VIO, Photon, and Electric Imp. Those are all Wi-Fi development boards. We have Zigbee boards like Zoetria, Z1, and Telos B. And we have Electron and Embed, which have GSM modems on board. So that's one way to do it. You start from this prototyping hardware. But there is even a more faster way that is becoming more popular. You can 3D print your product. So there are companies like Nascent Objects that provide this kind of service where you upload your 3D model of your product. Then you select electronic modules like CPU, sensors, etc. And then the 3D printer embeds conductive threads into the body of the objects. And you just slide in electronic modules like SIM cards. So there is no need to, you know, do an expensive PCB manufacturing. With this kind of coupling of 3D printing, modular electronics, and smart software, you can do this very rapidly. Then if you move to the operating systems, you know, before typically you had applications running on MCUs that did not necessarily require an operating system. But now Internet of Things is more demanding, like you need to add wireless connectivity to your product, so you need some protocols, you probably need some security code, and it's really hard or impossible, you know, to implement this without an operating system. So you need an operating system which can run on a very constrained device with very little memory and computing power. And there are many of those. Here I show just the most popular ones. You're probably familiar with FreeRTOS, which is a very lightweight, I don't know if you can even call it an operating system. It's a real-time scheduling kernel. It's really tiny. It supports concurrency through, I say this, I put here MT, like multi-threading, but I'm not sure if that's the right word because there is no concept of processes in FreeRTOS. And then there is contributed software for FreeRTOS that adds connectivity, like micro UDP TCP IP stack for FreeRTOS. And then if you compile FreeRTOS with, for example, just UDP without TCP, the memory footprint would be something around 7 kilobytes. And then we have TinyOS and Contiki, which are targeting sensor networks. These are not real-time operating systems. They are event-driven. They support concurrency through preemptive threading, and Contiki has something called proto-threads that are very lightweight, stackless threads. Since they're targeting sensor networks, they have extensive support for wireless protocols, in particular IETF protocols like 6LoWPAN, micro IP version 6, UDP, TCP, RPL, co-op, etc. About the footprint, I don't really have the data for TinyOS. This is just if you compile it without any networking support. But if you compile Contiki with TCP and UDP, you will get a memory footprint of 30 kilobytes. So quite tiny. But these are really bare-bone operating systems. And then some argue that, you know, not all IP objects are so constrained in terms of memory and computational power. So you need something to bridge the gap between these sensor network type operating systems and, for example, embedded Linux. So there is an operating system that does that. It's called Riot. And it claims to be more, much more development friendly, because in Contiki and TinyOS, of course, you had to make some sacrifices, so they're not really user friendly. And another advantage of Riot is that, unlike TinyOS and Contiki, it is a real time, it supports multi-threading. And it has an extensive support for the networking protocols. So basically, that is the landscape for constrained embedded devices. But then I said that there are other more powerful platforms on top of which you want to implement your IoT products. And those are more likely to use something like embedded Linux. And there are many toolkits. There are many toolkits that allow you to compile your customized embedded Linux code. And you know, the disadvantage with embedded Linux, that it's still, even if you strip down all the unnecessary features, it's quite a chunky piece of code, which has a large memory footprint. So there's no way that you can run it on an 8-bit or 16-bit microcontroller, not even probably on a Cortex-M3. It needs something more powerful. And there is a newcomer to this family of the embedded Linux distributions. It's called Google Brillo. There was a developer's preview, I think, a few months ago. It will appear next year. It is like a stripped-down version of Android. You know, the success of Google Brillo is, it will depend on how many devices Google manages to push this solution. So we don't really have more details about the Google Brillo. Let's see how this plays out. About the IoT platform. So what are IoT platforms? This is middleware, kind of a glue that allows you to run your IoT applications across the boundaries of different operating systems, different language bindings, and different hardware platforms. And most IoT platforms nowadays are targeting this smart home segment. So you have and the lifestyle segment. So you have smart things bought by Samsung, Nest bought by Google, an Apple HomeKit for smart home applications. There is Apple HealthKit and Google Fit for health and wellness. And so on. You see basically that Google, Apple, and Samsung are dominating this market, which is quite fragmented. So you have different IoT platforms that compete in different IoT market segments. And even within each market segment, you don't have a clear winner. You have multiple platforms competing with each other. But in my opinion, you know, these some of these platforms will disappear, some of them will converge, and it is likely that in the future we will have four big players, maybe four, maybe more. I think these are the most obvious candidate. We have IoTivity, created by Samsung and Intel. It's an open source platform which provides functionalities basically like more like any other IoT platform, functionalities to discover devices and resources, to do the device management, to do the data management, and to do data transfer, of course, as a main functionality. IoTivity is going to support, it supports now a number of operating systems like Android, Linux, Tizen, and it works with many different wireless connectivity solutions, Bluetooth, low energy, Wi-Fi, Zigbee, etc. Then we have AllJoin, which is I think developed by Intel and then handed over to the Linux Foundation. And AllJoin provides pretty much the same set of functionalities like IoTivity. It supports a wider range of operating systems and language bindings, but unfortunately it only supports Wi-Fi at the moment. And then we have Apple HomeKit, which is not open source like the other two, so it's closed source, and it relies on something called HomeKit Accessory Protocol, so it doesn't provide full interoperability. Device that wants to use HomeKit has to be made for iOS certified. So it is more likely, most likely, that Apple is going to create like a small ecosystem of these HomeKit-based devices, which are so-called premium segment. It's for the market that cares more about Apple logo rather than interconnectivity. And then we have Wave, Google Wave. It is kind of a language which was announced to at the same time as Brillo, so it will work with Brillo and Android. And it allows developer to create his own syntax to add the terms to this language that can be used, you know, to manage the device, to initiate the data transfer, and to do the data management. So that's the IoT platform landscape. And in the last two slides, this is the last part of the presentation. Although I'm not a software developer, I try to give to approach IoT from more like a software developer's perspective, which I guess would be interesting for you. And here I show some survey data that comes from the Code Project, which is software big software developer community. The developers were asked, well, those that are working on connected products were asked on what kind of connected products are they working on. And there were two surveys, one in 2014, one in 2015. And you see the results. And in the category of IoT connected devices, which fall mostly into the category of embedded and M2M systems and products and smart home products, we have largest number of IoT developers, and among the old respondents to this survey, 31% declared that they are working on IoT development in 2015, and that is up from 23 in the previous year. So this is fast-growing developers community, and they're working mostly on embedded solutions and smart home products, as you can see here as well. So smart home is leading, followed by retail. And then there are some interesting observations that are not in this slide. These developers who work on IoT products, they were also asked to, you know, say how would they describe themselves. Are they like senior developers, gurus, or they are more like enthusiasts? And it turns out that most of those who work on IoT products are enthusiasts, and that only 15% of them managed to make more than $10,000 per month. And then you compare that to the developers who work on cloud services, for example, where 28% of them make more than $10,000. And this tells you something about this IoT market that is really not mature yet, and that, you know, experienced developers, like most of them, they decide not to join this kind of gold rush for a moment. And in the last slide of this presentation, I wanted to tell you about the challenges that IoT brings. Not only challenges, I say challenges / implications. And here I would dare to say that IoT doesn't bring any new challenges. So IoT, the complexity of IoT, it just exposes developers to such a wide range of challenges, but those challenges are not new. Those challenges are well known, and they've been tackled and addressed in different scopes outside of IoT. So don't be surprised that you will not hear anything particularly new here. As an example, security and privacy, it's a well-known problem, right? And enterprise and web developers, they deal with it on a daily basis. They know that they need good security solutions to protect their communication against the attacks. But many embedded developers that now embark on the IoT, they used to work on the products where not all features and or aspects of security were important. They, for example, cared more about the physical security. And now suddenly these products also need to communicate. They are not cut off from the world. They need to communicate to other devices. And that requires new comprehensive security solutions. And for example, one problem that was mentioned in the previous question and answer section was privacy. IoT will open a whole range of privacy issues because some of these IoT devices will collect your private data. You remember the example with the Nest thermostat, who learns your daily patterns, and then imagine that someone taps into that data and learns things like when do you leave home, etc. So I believe that solutions to these problems already exist, just they need to be, they're not quite adapted to the world of IoT. For example, you cannot expect a user of IoT device to enter a password in his smartphone whenever he wants to onboard a smart device like a light bulb in the home. So you need more streamlined, simplified solutions, right? You cannot expect this user, which might not be so tech savvy, to update certificates on his devices. So that's one problem, security. And then another big problem is achieving interoperability compliance. So As I said, one of the key defining elements of IoT is interoperability of different hardware platforms, different networking protocols, different middlewares. And this interoperability can be achieved through standardization or through common middleware that everyone would use. But this is quite far-fetched. I don't think that there will be a common IoT protocol standard in the foreseeable future. And there will definitely not be one IoT platform, one middleware that everyone would use. So then you have to have some kind of ad hoc solutions. And what you can do per protocol or per system compliance tests. Or you can expose your APIs to other developers to fall. And this is not ideal. It puts lots of burden on software developers and makes it really hard to identify problems that may appear. And then another challenge, as I said, some of these IoT devices are really constrained in terms of energy. In particular, they run on these coin cell batteries, so you need power optimized code. And very often you need some very advanced computer science know-how to implement those power optimized algorithms. But hopefully there will be more and more libraries available that are already optimized and that you can reuse. Another way, more difficult, is to use device power management. So you switch off your device when it doesn't have to be up and running. And this is something that typically an operating system does for you, right? But in IoT products and applications, you will have these many interconnected devices working together, and then how an operating system on one particular device can know that it can go to sleep now. So for that reason, you need to implement this power management in your IoT application. So that's the hard problem. Another challenge is heterogeneity of devices, which requires versatile and scalable code. So you need a scalable code design methods so that your code can run across the boundaries of different hardware platforms. And this is also a hard problem. Another problem is the adoption of third-party components. So IoT products can be quite complex, right? As I said, you need communication protocols, you need security, and you don't want to start from scratch. So there are already mature and tested solutions, so why not borrow those and relieve some burden from yourself or from your development team? But then you run into all kinds of compatibility problems. For example, many of the embedded platform vendors, they bundle development kits together with their hardware, you know. So many embedded developers, they base their products on these development kits, and many of these development kit modules, they end up in the final product. And these embedded hardware vendors, they don't really care about doing thorough compatibility tests. They see this, in many cases, these development kits and something that you get extra with their hardware for free or for a low cost. And then later on, you run into all kinds of compatibility problems because this components of the development kits, like drivers and operating system and protocols, are sourced from different vendors, not thoroughly compatibility tested, very often not eligible for software updates and bug fixes. And when the problem happens, you don't know with whom the responsibility lies to fix this. And the last bullet is about feedback-driven development model. And this is not really a problem, right? In the title slide, there is challenges slash implications, and this is more kind of an implication. So now you're dealing with connected products, connected devices that send abundance of data about how these products are used and what are their performances. And you can plug in this real-time data into your software development process, into your simulation procedures, and do and that would enable you to more easily and faster find problems in the software development, right? The old way would be to rely on thorough simulations before you roll out the product. And after you roll out the product, you look it into the historical data. But now, many of these IoT platforms, they provide you an API for this real-time data streams that you can use for detecting the problems in your software design. And with this, I conclude the presentation. And now we have a Q&A session.
Hello. So what do you actually do at Nokia within the IoT field?
I'm a radio systems engineer. I work in the same team with Matthias and Fernando. So I work on 5G solutions for mission critical communication.
Okay, so you doesn't really do the actual devices, only the communication.
Yeah, I developed 5G concepts for mission critical communication. So it's very, low level radio system stuff. And I also coordinate collaboration with verticals companies in the areas of like connected driving, autonomous driving, etc.
Okay, so Nokia does not tackle the IoT directly.
Depends how you define IoT. As I mentioned, many people in radio systems and many people in Nokia, they put this equation sign between IoT and M2M. And while we actually work on M2M, we tend to say that we work on IoT. While I see this as like, two things that have a very different scope.
I want to ask you for IPv4 protocol in IoT, because on this page with protocol stack there was only IPv6. Thank you.
Yes, of course. In this, maybe I should have included it. It is included in IoT protocol stacks. It's simply that there is this view that in the future you will have an enormous number of these IoT devices and that you will exhaust the IPv4 address space. So IPv6 is seen as a key enabler for the IoT. That's why when you talk about the IoT, you typically talk about IPv6 rather than IPv4.
More questions? No? Okay, so thank you very much. That was Vladimir Vukalinovich. Thank you.